Thank you for the opportunity to present my work as part of the Developmental Psychology Master Lecture Series with the APA. I'd like to actually begin with a land and labor acknowledgement. And although I am not physically with you at APA, unfortunately, due to some travel problems, the APA is in fact taking place on the ancestral and occupied territory of the Dakota people, who originally inhabited and settled the land. I also wish to acknowledge the legacy of enslavement of both Indigenous people and of the enslaved Africans whose labor was exploited for generations to establish the economy of our nation and build and support the advancement of many institutions of higher education of which we are a part. These legacies and features of the socio-historical context are always important to acknowledge, particularly because we must continue to do all that we can to make the invisible visible, but they are also particularly relevant to the work that I do, focused on young people's development as it relates to identities that are marginalized on the basis of race and ethnicity. And it's the continued negative impact of these legacies that really make a focus on adolescents' ethnic racial identity development so very important. So let me tell you a little bit about this work. In my career, I have focused almost exclusively on studying the development of ethnic racial minoritized youth in the context of the United States. And what we know about the U.S. context is that all people in the U.S. experience a racialization of their identities based on race, ethnicity, immigrant status, documentation status, and the intersection of these social identities. This means that as adolescents are increasingly thinking about who they are and who they will become, their ethnic racial identity is a big part of the identity development process. This also means that in the United States, developing an understanding of who you are in relation to this social identity is important, particularly because of the salience of this social identity in this particular social context. This is consistent with self-categorization theory, which suggests that in societies where inequities based on a particular social identity are pervasive, that social identity domain will be salient. And our young people are certainly exposed to these inequities on a regular basis, and this is salient through them through various mediums in which they're engaging on a daily basis in their lives. We also know from theory that when young people are racially othered, these experiences inform their identity as it pertains to their sense of worth and their sense of belonging in that particular society. And this racialization informs whether they're viewed as an in-group member, an out-group member, how they're treated, and most importantly, their access to power. All of this informs the way that they see themselves and ultimately their identity. And this racialization has significant implications for young people from ethnic racial minoritized groups, but also ultimately for our society at large. And this is because ethnic racial minoritized status is a developmental risk factor. And it's a developmental risk factor because it places our young people at risk for experiences with ethnic racial discrimination. And these experiences are significantly linked with maladjustment. We've seen this based on a significant abundance of evidence, of empirical evidence, with respect to health outcomes. But we also see a plethora of studies that have documented that students who are marginalized on the basis of this racialization also, on average, are faring relatively poorly in the domains of education and also in multiple domains of mental health. And all of this evidence helps us to understand why we continue to see such significant ethno-racial achievement gaps in our society that we're failing miserably to eradicate, which is a major problem for the future of our nation, given that a majority of our K-12 student body is actually comprised of students of color. And in a few short years, this K-12 student body population is the group that we are looking to for leadership and innovation in our nation, meaning that ultimately, the future success and well-being of our society will depend on how well we're addressing issues of ethnic racial inequity in our education system now and in the immediate future, because ultimately we're not currently serving the majority of our student population. So at this point, this all seems very bleak, but it's important to remember that a prevention science framework suggests that we can effectively prevent maladjustment and promote adjustment by building on, strengthening, and supporting developmental competencies that can serve as protective factors and promote resilience. And in fact, we've built a significant empirical base that tells us that supporting culturally based developmental competencies, such as ethnic racial identity, can promote adjustment and protect youth from maladjustment in the face of these risk factors. And so this is where ethnic racial identity comes in. So what is ethnic racial identity anyway? As a developmental scientist who studies adolescent development in context, my work is grounded in two primary conceptual notions. First, that identity formation is a key developmental task that gains momentum in adolescence. And as individuals are gaining a greater sense of clarity regarding the personal meaning of their identity, and that is being achieved via meaningful exploration, this contributes to greater identity synthesis and cohesion and less role confusion. And these things are critical for psychosocial functioning, both in terms of the ability to engage in positive relationships with others and the abilities to build a positive self-concept. Second, this work is largely grounded in social identity theories and this idea that identity formation is context dependent, such that one's self-concept is largely informed by how salient particular social group memberships are in a particular social context, and also based on how one views the groups to which we perceive ourselves to be members of, and how we think that others are viewing these groups that we perceive ourselves to be members of. So with this conceptual grounding as a backdrop, I define ethnic racial identity as the aspect of one's social identity that's derived from these ethnic racial group memberships. It's informed both by our ethnic heritage and our racialized experiences in a specific socio-historical context. It reflects our feelings and thoughts about our ethnic racial group membership, but it also reflects the extent to which we've engaged in this process to gain knowledge about our ethnic racial groups, and we've come to a resolution or a sense of clarity regarding the personal meaning that ethnic racial identity has in our lives. It's important in this definition, I find it important to distinguish between process and content, because process is really getting at these developmental features. So it's the process of how we're coming to understand the implications of race and ethnicity in our lives. And this really is reflecting the process of exploration, of learning more, of engaging and participating in these experiences to learn about oneself, and then also resolution or gaining that sense of clarity. On the other side of things is the content. And so process versus content, with content really referring to the affect. So what are our attitudes towards this group membership? This includes concepts such as affirmation, public regard, or how others perceive our group, centrality, knowledge, things of that nature. And so when we think about the developmental conceptualization of ethnic racial identity, we have an abundance of empirical evidence demonstrating that ethnic racial identity is in fact a developmental competency. First, existing empirical evidence for decades now has documented that as individuals are doing more to explore and resolve their understanding of their ethnic racial identity, we see more links, positive links with adjustment and negative links with maladjustment. We also know from a significant empirical base that as adolescents are progressing from early adolescence through middle and late adolescence, they are increasingly exploring and resolving their identity with respect to race and ethnicity and starting to really gain a clearer sense of self with respect to who they are and how they feel about their ethnic racial group membership. And it's no coincidence that these age-graded developmental changes are taking place during the same developmental period where we are seeing tremendous changes in the adolescent brain. There are, of course, many important developmental changes taking place during adolescence. Young people are increasingly gaining more cognitive maturity that's enabling them to think more about abstract concepts such as race and ethnicity and how they pertain to them personally. They're increasingly socially aware and exposed to more diverse settings and people, which also prompts and sets the stage for more exploration. And they're increasingly focused on defining themselves and thinking about themselves in more multifaceted and complex ways. And so all of this together really suggests that the period of adolescence is an ideal time for intervention. And this brings me to the Identity Project. So the Identity Project intervention was developed as a universal health promotion program designed really to advance individuals' ability to achieve key developmental competencies, and particularly ethnic racial identity. It was targeted to the general population of youth rather than specific to any high-risk or at-risk youth exclusively. It's also targeted to youth from all ethnic racial backgrounds rather than one specific group, really in recognition of this idea that the content of one's exploration will vary, but the process of exploration really should be universal. And we very explicitly focused on the development period of adolescence and middle adolescence because of the social and cognitive changes that are taking place during this time. So the Identity Project was developed as a school-based program. The specific targets of this intervention are ethnic racial identity exploration and resolution. The intervention provides an opportunity for students to learn and participate strategies, tools, and have the time with which to discuss issues of race and ethnicity in the school setting, opportunities to explore their ethnic racial background and learn about their peers' backgrounds, and opportunities really for them to reflect on the personal meaning of this aspect of their identity. It provides a manualized curriculum for educators that follows a learning arc such that students really begin with sharing their existing knowledge and building new basic knowledge about the concepts of race and ethnicity. Then they're exploring their identities in relation to these concepts and thinking about both themselves and their peers in relation to these concepts. Ultimately, the curriculum is providing adolescents with these messages continuously that they actually have the agency in deciding who they are and how they think of themselves with respect to race, ethnicity, and identity. The Identity Project curriculum consists of 8 lessons, which are designed to be delivered once per week, and they last approximately 1 hour each. And the theory of intervention suggests that as adolescents are engaging in these processes and in these experiences in the classroom, they're then prompted to do more exploring of their own ethnic racial identity, which then leads to increases in our sense of clarity or resolution regarding this aspect of the self, ultimately promoting greater global identity cohesion and having positive downstream impacts on their psychosocial identity or psychosocial adjustment with respect to many different indicators of psychosocial adjustment. So what's the evidence? To initially test the efficacy of the Identity Project, we conducted a randomized control trial. We had both an intervention and an attention control group. And students in the control group received the same amount of contact time with facilitators, as well as the same types of activities. So if the intervention group was having a homework assignment, the attention control condition was also getting a homework assignment. And with this very significantly controlled design, what we found actually was that, in fact, consistent with our theory of change, adolescents experienced increases in ethnic or demonstrated increases in ethnic racial identity exploration as a function of this intervention. So we saw experimentally induced increases in ethnic racial identity exploration. These increases in exploration led to increases in ethnic racial identity resolution only for young people in the intervention condition. We did not see these links for students in the control condition. And ultimately, our findings demonstrated a year later positive cascading effects on adolescents' grades, adolescent self-esteem, lower depressive symptoms, and also increased global identity cohesion among young people in the intervention condition in particular. We also have new evidence from one of our recent projects, the My Life, My Identity project. We refer to it as the MLMI, that really helps us to understand the potential for scale up and get a more in-depth understanding of students' and teachers' perceptions of the identity project. In the MLMI project, we've trained ninth grade U.S. history teachers to implement the identity project with their students. We surveyed approximately 180 students from these classes, and we were, in addition to the surveys, able to conduct daily diary check-ins with students twice a week as the intervention was being implemented by their teachers. We also conducted interviews with teachers. The teacher training program was a 32-hour professional development program that we developed. It targets or focuses on four different learning domains for educators. And the one that I really want to highlight here is throughout this 32-hour professional development, teachers are gaining experience and opportunities to really reflect on their own ethnic racial identity development. So in a sense, what we're doing is we're also intervening in teachers' ethnic racial identity by providing them with the tools and the strategies and the time with which to explore their own ethnic racial identity. And I can share more about this teacher professional development in another opportunity. I know our time is limited here. But what we've seen with the MLMI study is that, in fact, we find similar results when this is implemented by teachers. So adolescents increase in their ethnic racial identity exploration at post-test after teacher implementation of the 8-week ethnic identity project. And so really exciting to see some similar results experimentally. But what we're also seeing is that we could gain some additional insights from students about what exactly are they engaging with when they are experiencing the identity project in their classrooms. And so these data are from the daily diary check-ins. And what we've learned from students is that they really appreciate the opportunity to explore and share their identity without judgment. They also really appreciate that the curriculum provides an opportunity for them to connect with their peers and build community. They also shared that they really appreciated the opportunity to talk about race, ethnicity, stereotypes, and discrimination. They felt like this curriculum provided them with an opportunity to connect with their family. So this is a school-based curriculum, but the activities and the homework assignments really are leading to students engaging in conversations with family about race, ethnicity, and identity. And finally, students have really shared that they appreciate the setting and the context within which the teacher is providing for them to be able to explore their identity. So many students mentioning that they really feel appreciative of their teacher creating a safe space. What we've heard from teachers is that they feel that the focus on ninth grade students is right on target. They also believe that this curriculum provides an excellent and important opportunity for them to build and strengthen student-teacher connections. And they also believe that the Identity Project is providing a concrete way for students to be able to see themselves in the curriculum. And they see that as essential for students' academic success and engagement, which we also know from the literature is in fact true. So what we've learned from this work thus far is that a program that provides young people with strategies, tools, and opportunities with which to explore and evaluate the relevance of their ethnic racial identity can result in young people engaging in greater exploration and developing a greater sense of clarity. We also see that these changes can positively inform adolescence adjustment 1 year later. And we also have found some similar program efficacy when teachers are trained to implement the program with their students. Finally, we've learned from these qualitative data we've been able to gather that both teachers and students appreciate and see value in discussing issues of race, ethnicity, and identity in the school setting. We believe that what's ultimately happening here is that the Identity Project is actually providing educators an entry point for engaging in culturally sustaining pedagogical practices with their students, which we know has tremendous significant and positive implications for student learners' academic and psychological outcomes. And we believe that this is happening by providing an opportunity for teachers to center students' ethnic racial identity in the school setting and their curriculum, and ultimately engaging teachers and students in a continuous process of exploration and discussion of race, ethnicity, and identity pertaining to them personally. So this is all very promising and exciting, but our biggest challenging at this point really is identifying how to promote and support educators and students' ethnic racial identity development in school settings. And the challenge is not related to how do we do this or the process or the curriculum by which that might happen. Our biggest challenge really is the current socio-political climate. And so we know that individual and systemic or structural biases based on the racialization I introduced earlier produce ethno-racial disparities, and that our education system must change to promote the academic achievement of all of our students. We also have considerable experimental, prospective, quantitative, and qualitative empirical evidence demonstrating that engaging students in discussions about race, ethnicity, and identity in school can promote their ethnic racial identity development and also promote psychological and academic adjustment. Yet we're in this highly contentious socio-political moment where there is a significant political and ideological divide with respect to discussing issues of race and related concepts in school. We have numerous states that have taken legislative action to restrict educators' abilities to teach about racism, power, privilege, and related concepts, with several states actually having current legal bans on having these discussions. There's a resistance to the work, therefore, at a macro level, where we have these policies that are directly limiting the curriculum. We also see a resistance to work from parents, and we see a resistance to this work on the part of teachers as well. On one part, some teachers really having ideological differences and not wanting to talk about race, but other teachers wanting to talk, have these conversations and really engage their students in these pedagogical experiences because they know that that's what's good for the students, but ultimately feeling confused and feeling scared about whether or not they can have these conversations. And there are a host of negative implications linked with this current socio-historical climate that we're in. First are implications for students, teachers, and administrators, in that these bills and legislative actions are really creating a climate of hostility, fear, and confusion. Second, this is dividing our school communities and really creating a toxic and hostile environment for teachers and administrators, making it very difficult to engage with issues of race, ethnicity, and identity with respect to any topic in the classroom. And ultimately, what this does is it promotes a color evasive approach to education where disparities are not being recognized, the root of these disparities are not interrogated, and ultimately, we're harming all of our students' learning and development because no one is learning how to think critically and engage in dialogue around these issues because they're being silenced. This has significant implications for our science because those of us who are able to do this work are doing it with a restricted range of the population. So our findings really are limited to a particular type of context where the topic is valued, it's understood, and it's supported. And ultimately what this means is that the students who likely are most marginalized, we're not getting to these students. We're not understanding how programs such as these could have potential benefits for their psychosocial adjustment. This has tremendous implications, however, for our society at large. What we know about our society is that it is set up such that academic achievement is a central gatekeeper to the economic mobility, the financial security, and other indicators of life chances. The grave disparities and inequities that we see in our education system due to systemic racism, coupled with the ethno-racial demographic trends of our K-12 student population, mean that we are not adequately serving or supporting the development of the majority of our students. Therefore, the inability for us to explicitly discuss race, ethnicity, and identity is not only going to maintain and possibly exacerbate these ethno-racial disparities that we see, but it also leaves us ill-prepared for the future. So in closing, I want to note that ethnic racial identity development is a developmental competency in which we must invest, and the school setting provides an ideal context within which to intervene, because it's a domain where our young people of color experience the most significant marginalization during this developmental period. And it also enables us to leverage a critical natural resource that can make a tremendous difference in our young people's lives, and that's teachers. But ultimately, for us to have a chance of seeing any real change in our society, nurturing and supporting students and teachers' ethnic racial identity development has to be recognized as an essential part of the academic curriculum. I thank you for your time, and I look forward to engaging with you on this work. Please reach out if you have any questions.